Hello, is it working? Okay, it's working. Okay, colleagues and friends, I'm happy to stand here and open APE annual conference. Some of older colleagues say that it's already 46, but no one remembers, is it true? So we just believe them. The title of the conference, you know, it's to be or not to be a great educator. And we were thinking about the title, which could cover all the challenges, all the problems, all the innovations which we face in education. And the titles, Challenges of 21st Century, Teacher of Future, they are already taken. So we decided to keep to classics and used a bit of plagiarism here. So thank you, Shakespeare. But it's to be or not to be a great educator. The world is changing, and someone says that it moves faster. Someone says that all the knowledge should be updated, but what knowledge should be updated and what knowledge is still relevant? It's a question for us as educators. Also, we have faced COVID and also other diseases could be our challenge, and we have to ensure that learning can happen. Learning can happen once educational institutions are closed. We have to be sure that students listen to us. We have to be sure that they learn something. But how to ensure that they learn something behind these screens? And even how to ensure that students who don't have screens learn. I think it's a big challenge for us, and it is not finished yet. War and other conflicts. At the moment, we all are shocked of barbarism of Russia during the war in Ukraine. But there are also other wars in the world. There were wars in Syria, Iraq. Right now it's war in Ethiopia. Of course, from our perspective, it's far away. But still, we have to think how to ensure that we teach culture, we teach value of dignity, value of peace, value of human life, how to keep, be pacific in a situation when someone kills your family, invades and destroys your country. These are big challenges. Wars on borders. Sometimes we think that situation can be solved by building new walls. Sometimes we think that ignoring problems, we will not face consequences. And sometimes it works. For example, when I don't tell my husband that this flower bed is not a good one. But indeed, in real situation, we have to face these problems. From the beginning of war in Ukraine, the democratic world was shaken up, and there were people who decided that it's not in their country. It's an Eastern European problem. It's not other countries' problem, but we can't hide behind the walls. And we all know that there were organizations who couldn't decide how to react in that situation. And there are still organizations who just today or yesterday say that they are moving out of Russia. And these are challenges for us as educators, how to teach courage, how to teach fight, how to learn being as brave as Ukrainians. Also propaganda and fake news. We all know what propaganda is, but today I would like to focus on educational propaganda. We all have heard such statements that there are no homeworks in Finland, and we try to understand how to teach students without homeworks. But it's not true. They have homeworks, of course they have. We also have heard that if learning process will be interesting all the time, students will learn and there will no problems be. There will not be any problems. But we also know that it's not true. There are problems also when it's interesting. And we should face them and we should find the way how to teach. We also have heard that educational technologies can solve all the problems. They can, of course, but they cost something and there should be appropriate materials for students. There should be appropriate pedagogical methodologies to teach. Otherwise, we can cause knowledge bricolage, fragmentism, etc. I can continue with more such statements like STEM knowledge will solve all problems. We also have heard that it's death of lecturer. We have to change. We have heard about digital natives and so on. But how to look realistic on such propaganda, how to support scientific thinking in all these situations. And we can continue the list of these challenges, but only answer is that education is led by great educators. To be or not to be a great educator, it's a question we pose and we hope, let's say hope, that some answers will be found here. We will discuss all the issues in conference, but now I would like to give, usually we say give floor, but now I will say give screen to Minister of Education and Science of Latvia, Anita Muižniece. And she will greet conference participants. Reinis.
Dear conference participants, the UNESCO report on the futures of education 2050 says that we must not fall into the illusion that education can solve all the world's problems. Education can do a lot, but it cannot do it all. Exploring educational opportunities to bring about global change is therefore a huge investment. Living in a world of change, we are convinced that knowledge and learning are the basis for renewal and transformation. As Rainis, a Minister of Education and Science, has said, only that which remains in constant change shall persist. And education is a strong foundation. Global challenges call for a reanalysis of why, how, what, where, and when we learn, meaning that education still needs to evolve to help build a peaceful, just, and sustainable future. The quality of education and effective management of the education system reduction of social inequalities in education, digital transformation of education and recognition of cultural heritage, innovations in various fields of study in schools and universities are just some of the topics discussed in Latvia and European Union. And I am very glad that annual conference of Association of Teacher Education in Europe takes place in Riga. I am sure it will serve as a platform to discuss a range of interconnected issues such as innovation in education, major challenges and scenarios for overcoming them, passion for work and interest in the cognitive process. It is important to talk on the problems posed by pandemics as well as to address the development of digital solutions and examine implications of new scientific discoveries. In the new circumstances of pandemic and post-pandemic society, how to make teaching inspirational, learning meaningful, and education more accessible. I am sure that this conference will help to find answers. Have a productive and creative event.
On this screen, no, in this floor today, Professor Muižnieks, who is our rector, and he is well-known scientist in biology, but as a rector, he is responsible for all the fields we represent in our university, and we believe that the field of education is his favorite one.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Linda Daniela, one of the organizers of this conference. Thank you all for being with us and sharing the nice possibility to be really together in person, not only on the screen, although it's also sometimes useful. And yeah, first of all, I'd like to say a few words about the university, which is, I believe, not for the first time, but nevertheless, every time it is an honor and pleasure to organize this distinguished meeting. And why? Because the University of Latvia, the name itself is strange enough for the universities, because we know that most of the universities in the world are named after the cities where they are located, not after the country where they reside. It's not the case for Latvia, because the fate of the university, the history of the university, is very, very closely linked to the history of the country. And the university in Riga was founded just a year after the independence of Latvia was established in 1918 after the World War I. And of course, there was education in Riga before. Riga was the leader in innovation in the development technologies of early 20th century in the Baltic region. There was a Polytechnical Institute, but the university for this region was in Tartu at that time, because Riga and Tartu belonged to the same province of the Tsar's Empire. And the citizens of Riga were very practically minded. They didn't want the mess which is usually associated with the students at the universities and everything which is out of the scope of very practically oriented education. That's why in mid-19th century, the Polytechnical was organized, and later on it was developed into Polytechnical Institute. But since the independence of the country was established, it was clear that the country needs full-fledged, comprehensive higher education, which can be provided by the university, and the country needs education in national language, which wasn't in place before, because in Tartu or in Riga before, it was all the higher educational tuition was done in, at the beginning, German, later on Russian, but there were no, in fact, education in Latvian. this was started here at the university, as well as for the first time in Riga, medicine, humanities, number of social sciences were taught at the university. And it's and since I said the university was founded in 1919, so we celebrated centenary a couple of years ago. But the statute of the university, the charter, was adopted precisely 100 years ago. In fact, it was on August 23, 1922. So we have again a possibility to celebrate additional centenary, although the charter has been changed a lot of times, and the university, of course, also has changed a lot of times. But what has remained, and what is in reality fact by now, that the university is the largest and the only comprehensive university. We have a number of other universities now, again in Latvia. Many of them have been somehow separated during the history from the university, so the university can be regarded as a mother for all the higher education system here in Latvia. And in many cases also for the teacher education system in Latvia, because the Teachers Association of Latvia played a paramount role in organizing universities, the understanding that the university should be the place where the new intellectual power is developed, where the highly educated people come from, and in the same time give over this education to the wider society. Outreach is one of the main topics of the university from the very beginning on, and one of the best means of how to obtain, how to secure this outreach, of course, was further education, giving further on this knowledge which was obtained at the university to the wider layers of society. That's why the action and the activities of the university from the very beginning on were very, very warmly recognized and prized by the society already in the first years of their activities of the university. That's why the university has so huge endowment, which is not typical for many universities in the Eastern Europe region. And that's why the university has also the duty to take care about a lot of buildings and assets which are not typically parts of, at least not for the European universities. For example, we have about 20 dwelling houses around the urban region in Riga, and we cannot give them up and sell them because they are donated by will, and this will says that those assets has to be used for education, not for just creating wealth or purpose by commercial activities. Nevertheless, as I said, the higher education system now in Latvia is very branched and versatile. We have four, let's say, research-oriented universities, including technical university, medical university, agricultural university. But as you see, those are somehow branch-oriented. The University of Latvia is the only one comprehensive. And at the moment, this comprehensiveness has resulted in quite a fragmented and, let's say, such a structure of the institutional structure of the university, which covers 13 faculties, 15 institutes, about 10 different research centers. And at the same time, there's about, we have also three medical colleges in the system of the university, and this is altogether about 17,000 students, which is not that much, but nevertheless, it's not the size of such a decent university, I would say. And the largest faculty amongst those 13 is the faculty of pedagogy, psychology, and art. The first name is the first accent in the name of this faculty is a pedagogy, meaning that the bulk of the students at the faculty are trained to be, are being trained to become teachers. Teachers starting from very basic level, which is probably the most important one, preschool teachers, kindergarten teachers, and then they go up with subject teachers for gymnasia and also development of new teaching technologies, new approaches and methods in where Linda, Professor Daniel is expert, virtual realities, adapted realities, employment of those new technologies in teaching. So it is a huge task and it is one of the main parts of the mission of the university, I'd say. Because the mission of the university is very concisely said in the slogan, which says Scientia Patria, which means for fatherland and science, and science being international. It's clear that you can do Latvian science or Russian science or whatever, but in the same time, this science should somehow serve the national needs of the development of the economy, of the society, of culture in Latvia. And that's why the development and teacher training, I would say, is one of the core businesses of our university. And although Linda said that I'm just a biologist, probably somehow my activities and so input into the development of teaching is not that important in my personal career. I would say that nevertheless, I have the rights to teach still, not only at the university, which is for professors more or less taken for granted, but also in the school, because from my first education also provided by this university, I'm a biologist and teacher, high school teacher in biology, for biology and chemistry. So for two subjects, which of course is very important also when we are discussing our now recent educational developments, because taking into account the demographical situation, the distribution of the nets of the schools, for our teachers it's very, very important to have dual specialization. Usually it's not enough to teach just biology. You cannot earn your living in this way, if you are working in school. And nevertheless, I believe that the teaching should, of course, include all the aspects of our development of our personalities. It's not only acquiring knowledge, it's acquiring skills and understanding values. Only when we have all those three aspects together, then we can think about the development of really new and intelligent members of our new societies. And although that world is changing so much and we have experienced so deeply, so tremendous and important changes during the last couple of years, starting with pandemics, where we learned new approaches to use technologies, and still we are reconsidering our teaching and learning habits by involving new distance learning tools, new technologies, new assessment and didactic methods in this field. And new, again, the next challenge, this unprecedented aggression by our neighboring country towards another, our neighboring country, we really feel in our everyday life, how it is when the huge number of newcomers from different countries with different language have to be somehow integrated into the life of the school and in the life of the university. And when we are facing new challenges with the energetic crisis, which really are very, very such a sensible about how we shall manage our teaching and learning during the forthcoming semester, which will begin next week already here in Latvia. And of course, we are in the same time, we are optimistic. We are looking forward to the final victory of reason. And we are looking forward also to the development of really versatile and comprehensive approach to all parts of arts of teaching and learning and making research, doing research at this university, and not only concentrating on STEM, which is usually, which of course is dear to me, of course, somehow one of those who have this STEM at the origins, but we surely see that the development of university and the society and economy and culture is not imaginable without decent and strong development of humanities and social sciences, and only this blend of the science and humanities at the level of the university and further on in the society will bring the needed change and needed development we are all striving at. And that's why it's also important to mention that we are now sitting in the building of Skrzyczkowa Building of Nature. And the next one we see neighboring here is the Building of Science. And those are the buildings which now give accommodation to biologists, chemists, physicists, medical students, and so on and so on. But a week ago, we have laid the cornerstone to the next building, the Building of Letters, and the main inhabitants of those this new building will be the Faculty of Pedagogy, Psychology, and Art, or probably it will be called some other name, but the main thing that the teacher training will be then supported by the most modern and updated infrastructure with new laboratories, with new workshops where the teachers will be the future teachers will be very, very close touch with the best what the new technologies, new approaches can afford. So I'd say by the end of my lengthy talk, but Linda allowed me to do so, and I'm not the one who has the possibility to speak with longer, as usually professors do. Yes. But I would like to get back to the motto or the motive of this conference, to be or not to be a good educator. And if you recall the author, Shakespeare, and at my education, which was again a long, long time ago, but we had to learn by heart, this manner. School. It was a challenge, of course. Still something is remaining after even tens of years of life. And I recall that by the end of the manual, there was a phrase that this consciousness does make cowards of all us, and the enterprise of great pitch and duty with this regard are overshed with pale cast of thought, and with this regard, their currents turn awry, something like that. The main thing is that the main topic I take from this those rows is that we should be more bold. Probably it's true. Probably, of course, I wouldn't say that we shouldn't think again at all. That, of course, consciousness, conscience is the part and parcel of our activities. But in the same time, if we just sit and wait, sometimes it's not enough. Sometimes we should act. And this conference is a part of really constructive and I believe productive actions, which will really bring the needed result, the new approaches, new ideas, new cooperations, in the end effect, bringing to the development of a great educator for all types of schools and also for the university, which I'm also working for. So thank you very much for being with us and very fruitful work at your conference. Thank you.
Professor Muzhnik, who is not only a biologist, but also a teacher and chemistry teacher, we usually give some souvenirs. You can guess that it's souvenir of University of Latvia, of course, but you know, usually it happens that you don't have the thing where you work. So yeah. Finally, you will have it.
Oh, yeah. Umbrellas are very ready. Today is still okay, but
tomorrow
it's forecasted. Thank you very much.
So now I would like to welcome on the stage President of ADE, Mihail Heinen. And besides that, he is a president of ADE, he is also a director of 4 master study programs in Marnix Academy. For those who don't know, where is Marnix? Is it Netherlands?
In the Netherlands, yes.
In Netherlands, okay. So please welcome him and he will give, I don't know, long, short, but speech.
I will keep it short. Welcome to Riga. And I immediately feel at home and I also feel a connection because I started my career as a teacher in biology after obtaining my degree in biology. So I feel at home. Dear colleagues, dear participants, dear friends, I'm extremely proud and happy to be here today with you. This is the ATE's first annual conference where we are able to physically meet again since the annual conference we had in Bath Spa University in the UK back in 2019, which seems like ages ago. Of course, as active ATE members and colleagues, we have never lost touch. We have met many, many times online, and last spring, some of us were able to meet again at successful ATE conferences in Italy and in Ireland. Nevertheless, traditionally, the annual conference is a big and special moment for the ATE and its members. So it is great that we are here today together. The ATE is a strong community with individual and institutional members from more than 20 countries in Europe, but also beyond. We conduct research together. We build on a practice of good quality teacher education and have impact on the European policy level by participating in European projects, but also in European Commission working groups. In this, our RDCs, the research and development communities, play a crucial role. The organizing committee gave the opportunity in the program to meet as RDCs. So if you're curious about RDC activities, please have a look at the program and feel free to join in the meetings mentioned there. Furthermore, the ATE is very, very proud of its journal, the European Journal of Teacher Education. More and more colleagues publish high quality papers, which is reflected in an impact factor that is getting higher and higher again. We are very grateful for the work of the editors, Anja Senne, who is here with us today from the Netherlands, and Maria Assunção Flores from Portugal. And of course, not to forget about the members of the editorial board. We are especially honored today that Maria will provide us with a keynote speech. Unfortunately, due to serious personal circumstances, she cannot be here physically, but as we have seen, the screen is working and helping us, so she will there be here online. The run-up to this conference was not easy. COVID is still among us and affects people in their health and ability to meet and work together. This still presents us with challenges, and that is why it is really great that the colleagues from Riga Latvia University have been making it able to attend online as well. Europe is facing big, big, big challenges. Linda has been referring to that. It shows the importance of being there for each other, supporting each other, helping each other in difficult times. Therefore, I would like to especially extend a warm welcome to all of our colleagues from Ukraine who are here today, physically, online, or in thought. Education is hope, and it makes the future. That is why we as AT members will always continue to work together to conduct research, train teachers, and strengthen and improve the quality of education. Teachers make the difference, and the role of the teacher educator is crucial, especially in uncertain times. For education, our work matters. We're facing several challenges, post-COVID effects on teachers and education in general, teacher shortages in several European countries, declining societal appreciation for the teaching profession, radical changes fueled by technological innovation. There is plenty to do for us today and the next years coming. This conference is going to help us to make this change with this guiding motive to be or not to be a great educator. An annual conference of AT cannot be a success without the commitment of many, many people. We thank the people of Latvia and Riga for their hospitality. We thank the University of Latvia and in particular the Faculty of Education, Psychology and Art. We thank all colleagues of the scientific committee and of course, all colleagues of the organizing committee led by Professor Linda Daniela. They all made it possible for us to be here online or offline, and we can enjoy a beautiful and inspiring conference. Please feel free and invited to share your thoughts and experiences via social media and make use of the hashtag ATEE2022. We will also have a Mentimeter, which is an online environment in which you can share thoughts and ideas. And we have printed these forms and we will spread them all over the building. I hope Linda doesn't mind. And you can go to the website, log in with the code and share with your colleagues. So also on behalf of all my colleagues from the Administrative Council, I wish all participants present here today, online or offline, sorry, the other way around, offline or online. No, I do it again, wrong. It's early, let's keep it that way. Be inspired, enrich yourself, be curious, and enjoy being here together in this fantastic place. Thank you very much and enjoy the conference.
Yes. Tomorrow it's promised that it will be raining. You have to bring it back home and you have to use it every time when it's raining, because it's with logo of University of Latvia. It's tricky.
Good publicity.
Yes, good publicity.
So, I will do so.
Thank you.
And in the Netherlands it rains a lot, so I'm gonna use it.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Next one, I will look in my screen. And here, what we have here? I have few sentences before keynote. Sorry, guys, you have to keep be patient. Where is my presentation? Because I don't know where. Okay, Rainis, you are making something for me.
You can share it.
Okay, I will skip some slides because Professor Muzhniak already told us about university. So you have maybe you have seen pictures of university. So it's the building where we are now. This one is next. You can go there to visit. It's open. You can just look around. It's a really nice one. And the last one will be for us, but not only for us. We are the biggest faculty, but not so big as this building. So we will have just part of this building for us. It's not built yet. So important information. It's organized in three streams, as Mikhail already mentioned. We have 127 presentations. We have 15 face-to-face sessions, 4 online sessions, 1 poster session, and 1 asynchronous session. Internet. So those who know my personal login, just forget it. You have to choose LU Wi-Fi login. It's written also there. If my slides are going too fast, so you can go LU Wi-Fi login VLAN 01, password ATE, and some other letters also. About papers, we expect that you submit your full papers until the end of September. I know that sometimes conferences pass and you forget to do that. Maybe I have to remind that conference proceedings from ATE conferences organized in Riga, at least from the year 2013 when I started to organize it, they are indexed in Web of Science. Maybe it will help as motivator for you. So water, it's clean. You can drink water from every tap here in Riga, even in parks. When you see tap water, you can drink it. You don't need to use specific medicine to make it clean. It's clean, really. You can find tap water also in halls here in this university. Those who wish to participate in excursion, you have on your badges red hearts. So if you paid for excursion, we will recognize you by red heart. Those who paid for social dinner, you have strange animals on your badges. We will meet in Gutenberg's restaurant. It's in city center, in this terrace. It's really nice. Unfortunately, it promised that it will be raining, but Michael has umbrella. Maybe he can help us to get there. Safety rules. Just regular safety rules. When you cross the street, you look one way, other way. You behave as it's usual. When you are in Central Market, just keep an eye on your wallet, but otherwise it's no one will take your bags by force, no problems really. Unless you will go to some bars this evening, next evening, there is a risk of hangover, you know that, but otherwise you are safe here. Now, a short video about the conference in Budapest next year. Again, Reinis. He's Reinis, by the way. And then we will meet.
house in Budapest, my hidden treasure chest, golden grand piano.
After 13 years, the ATE annual conference will again be held in Budapest. Budapest is the capital of Hungary, located in Central Europe on the banks of the Danube. The city has many historical sites and is a popular tourist destination, easily accessible by plane and train.
Give me one good reason why I should never make a change.
The event is organized by ERTE, the oldest university in Hungary. Its slogan, a modern university with 380 years of tradition.
The university has now 9 faculties and almost 30,000 students.
ERTE has been training teachers since 1814 and is the largest teacher training institution in the country. It provides not only pre-service training, but also in-service training, doctoral training for teachers, and international doctoral sub-program focusing on teacher education, EDITE. The conference is organized by the Faculty of Education and Psychology, known as ELTE PPK, one of the youngest faculties of the university, founded in 2003. The faculty is involved in teacher training and offers courses in education, psychology, adult education, and recreation. The venue is the faculty's central building in the city center, which is easily accessible due to its central location. The theme of the conference will be Teacher Education on the Move. The conference will take place between the 27th and the 30th of August 2023. All are welcome to attend, whose research topic concerns the change, the evolution, and the transformation of teacher education and its environment.
Give me one good reason why I should never make a change. Baby, if you owe me, then all of this will go away. My house in Budapest, my hidden treasure chest, golden grand piano, my beautiful Castillo, you, I'd leave it all.
Small bits to not bother you, but I have some small information. So, one more. Organizing committee has green badges. If you have some problems, you just address some of our colleagues who has green badges. Other colleagues, you have blue ones. Not clean blue one, but some bluish. Of course, we believe that you will not have any problems, but we faced already some. For example, we lost one box with badges. You know, some classics say, there is one saying, I don't know the classic, which I have to reference now, but the saying is, happens. You know. So we will solve it. Welcome reception will be today, and it will be held somewhere here around. It will be drinks around, but the main welcome evening, I don't know how it's called, welcome reception will be held inside. So a bit inside and then outside. To make it very entertaining, we addressed Lady Gaga. You know, it's very expensive. We couldn't afford that. Then we tried Rolling Stones. They said that they are too old. They won't come. So we made open contest who will be there. So we will see today who will come. What else I should tell you? No, nothing. Now we go to keynote speeches. So I see that Maria Asuncio Flores is already here. And a bit of introduction. Professor Flores works at University of Minho in Portugal. She received her PhD at University of Nottingham. Her research interests include teacher professionalism and identity, teacher education and professional development, curriculum, assessment, leadership, and higher education. She has published extensively on these topics, both nationally and internationally. She is past chair of International Study Association on Teachers and Teaching and past chair of the board of directors of the International Council of Education for Teaching. She is currently co-editor of the European Journal of Teacher Education. Dear professor, screen is yours.
Good morning. Thank you very much. I hope you can hear me well. I'm just trying to share my screen. Is it working? Can you see my screen? I think it's working well, right?
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. I am. I would like to thank the Association for Teacher Education in Europe and Professor Linda Daniela for their kind invitation to give this keynote address. Unfortunately, due to unforeseen circumstances, I am not able to be physically in Riga. I hope to be there next time. I'm really sorry about that. So I will try to share with you some ideas and some thoughts, also connecting with what has been said in the introduction, the welcome session, about the challenges for teachers, for students, for teacher educators in these post-pandemic times. So my idea is to share some thoughts, some reflections drawing on research about being a teacher or being an educator and a teacher educator in pandemic times. What are the lessons learned and the ways forward? We know that overnight, the idea of the pandemic brought about changes in education. And teachers and teacher educators work with almost no preparation or previous reflection. All of a sudden, the teaching scenario have changed, and both teachers, teacher educators, and students had to adapt quickly to the new reality. And in this context, we might ask, how do we envisage change in the aftermath of the pandemic? Is there a before and after COVID-19 pandemic in terms of change within education in general and teacher education in particular? If so, how can this change be characterized? How have teachers and teacher educators experienced it? What characterizes teaching in the post-pandemic age? Although the pandemic, as we know, was universal, we know also that teachers, teacher educators, and students did not experience it in the same way. Schools and universities were closed, and teachers and teacher educators had to operate in a new scenario under challenging circumstances, trying to reach out to their students and teach remotely. Some see this unprecedented, rapid, and forced shift from face-to-face to remote teaching as an opportunity to reform education and also teacher education. and or even as a revolution that needs to be continued, especially when it comes to digitalization and the use of digital tools. Others, meanwhile, are more cautious and call into question its implications in terms of equity and social justice. Those who were already at a disadvantage, whether through a lack of technology, the influence of poverty, or underserved schools, experience even more profound effects. Clearly, issues of inequality and exclusion in education became more visible and were exacerbated during the pandemic. So, how should we look at change in this context? Are we dealing here with an impetus to transform practices, or are we simply talking about an interruption to business as normal, which may have been a significant experience, but with limited effects on teaching practice and how teachers and teacher educators work after returning to their schools, to their universities, and to their usual way of doing things? On a global scale, the disruptions to schools and to teachers' work were well documented in the media and drew attention to the new arrangements for school at home and to the scale and complexity of the impact of the pandemic on teaching, on teacher education, and on learning. We also can have a look at international publications, an example of which is the European Journal of Teacher Education, the Journal of the Association for Teacher Education in Europe. And there was a special issue that was published in 2020, the COVID-19 pandemic and its effects on teacher education. And here we can find several examples about how the ways in which the pandemic have affected the work and the lives of teachers, students, and teacher educators. According to the OECD, the COVID-19 crisis forced school closures in 188 countries, heavily disrupting the learning process of more than 1.7 billion children, youth, and their families. While there are many aspects to the impact of the pandemic on education and how teachers deal with the experience, my focus today is on teaching, on teachers' work, and also on the implications for teacher education. I will use extracts of teachers speaking in their own words, which powerfully illustrate some of the key issues. For instance, Hargreaves identifies four pandemic changes that have affected the nature of teaching and consequently also the nature of teacher education. First of all, children were taken out of school to experience learning in some form or another from home. For shorter or longer periods of time, all students experienced learning remotely. And even when they got back to school, blended arrangements were often in place to deal with safety and health issues. The second change concerned the experience of lockdown from the perspective of teachers, as they were forced to teach in a virtual environment, which meant that they had to develop digital competencies, ranging from mastering technical tools to developing new pedagogies. Another issue relates to the profound changes in teachers' work and also in teacher educators' work when schools and universities reopened under conditions of physical distancing. For instance, teachers and also teacher educators spending time enforcing mask wearing, sanitizing procedures, but also teaching students who were separate from each other, trying to sustain cooperative learning activities in physically distanced environments and so on. Finally, teaching as a collaborative and social profession. As Hargreaves suggests, the work of teaching draws on the social and moral support of colleagues. And during the pandemic, teachers were away from their routine conversations and interactions at school. However, teaching in a remote environment also had the potential to expand the ways that teachers interacted with their colleagues throughout online networks, for instance. So, what do we know about teaching and teachers' work and also teacher educators' work following the outbreak of the pandemic? I will try to summarize key research findings, which I think may help us to reflect on its implications for teaching, for rethinking teacher education, and for student learning. And I will do so using three main themes: adapting to technological tools and digital platforms, the reconfiguration of teaching and learning, and the impact of the pandemic on the social professional dimension of teachers' work. In spring 2020, emergency remote teaching was rapidly put in place, but a number of problems were identified from the outset. Technical problems, lack of adequate equipment, and discrepancies in access to technology devices and to internet access were identified. Teachers talked about the initial shock and how they dealt with the unexpected closure of schools and the search for ways of reaching out to their students. For instance, this teacher here states that the first time was a moment of shock and trying to do everything that was possible to keep in touch with my students, being there for them, supporting them and their families. In his analysis of teachers' state of readiness to face the challenges of the COVID-19 lockdown, Schleicher concluded that teachers in most of education systems covered by the PISA 2018 were unprepared for digital learning. Only younger teachers exposed to using technology during their formal preparation or employing in it in teaching activities could be considered prepared for the pandemic requirements. And among teachers who responded to the TALIS 2018 survey, only 60% benefited from professional development in ICT. Furthermore, a report by UNESCO based on information from ministries of education in over 100 countries also noted differences by country income level in their capacity to track student learning, improve connectivity, support teachers, and offer special training in ICT skills. Between 25% and 31% of low-income countries were not providing any of these necessary conditions for teaching in COVID-19 pandemic times. The need to improvise the classroom in their homes and to maintain contact with their students meant that teachers were forced to take up digital learning. At the beginning of the COVID-19 crisis, this involved them doing emergency remote teaching, but later it also led them to create appropriate online tools and resources, as well as develop a more planned pedagogical response. These quotes are illustrative of the efforts made by teachers who had to switch their mode of teaching without the necessary preparation. They also talk about the learning that came about their experience. During the first lockdown, the focus was on changing everything from one day to the next. We had to adapt overnight in order for the students' learning to be affected as little as possible. In 2 weeks, I had to learn a lot about apps, none of whose name I knew, but which proved to be so useful that I intend to go on using them in my classroom teaching. So teachers recall a sense of discovering a new world as they become familiar with digital platforms and online tools, Google Meet, Zoom, Mentimeter, Google Classroom, Teams, Socrative, etc. So they also mention opportunities for professional development, especially in digital competencies. And these involve, of course, a variety of forms. Courses, modules provided by the Ministry of Education, by their schools, by teacher centers, but also informal learning and also self-training from the part of the teachers. A large study conducted in Portugal indicated that only 14% of the participating teachers had prior experience of some sort of distance teaching, which was a key element in explaining a more positive adaptation to the new teaching scenario imposed by the pandemic. Research has also shown that teachers' lack of digital know-how and the absence of relevant professional development opportunities were key variables in explaining how the teachers adapt to the distance teaching. Other research also highlights the teachers' concern about not being pedagogically prepared to teach remotely. So now, in 2022, almost every teacher has experience of working remotely. So the question is, what can we say about how teaching has been reconfigured as a result of the experience of teaching during the pandemic? There were new challenges regarding communication with students and support from their learning. And also research has shown that teachers claimed that their teaching has changed greatly or completely in a remote scenario. So one of the key questions that we can identify is the changing of interaction patterns when it comes to teaching remotely. Teachers had to reassemble their skills into new forms of teaching. Being unsure of how effectively they could reach their students, they had to implement different communication activities and systems. These ranged from physical delivery of learning materials or WhatsApp messages to students without online connection, to the use of teaching and learning platforms for online communication. So teachers' usual effectiveness of their working methods was challenged by concerns about how to perform the ritual tasks of planning, communicating, and assessing in ways that would be meaningful and accessible to their students. Research points to difficulties in getting in touch with students and involving them in the activities, but also to the lack of interaction and spontaneity. There were variations in the level of students' engagement depending on their socioeconomic background. Results from a study conducted in Portugal, for instance, show that pupils from low socioeconomic backgrounds participated less in remote teaching and learning activities. In other words, in schools where pupils' socioeconomic background is low, teachers report lower levels of student participation and compliance with tasks and assignments, and also lower levels of pupil satisfaction compared with teachers in schools with pupils from high socioeconomic backgrounds. What is clear from the data is the steep learning curve regarding the technicalities of using ICT in teaching, but also the exploration of new tools and platforms for online teaching related to preparing materials, content approach, pedagogical interaction, and also assessment. To quote from one teacher, online teaching was quite positive for more shy students because they had different opportunities to engage in tasks which were not just about oral activities. In some cases, I think that students were a lot more engaged. So despite the difficulties, the need to change teaching strategies was assumed to be unavoidable. However, this process was neither easy nor linear. Teaching remotely in some cases led to adopting a more structured step-by-step orientation so that students would not be, get lost. To quote from one teacher, "Online teaching somehow reduced the dialogical nature of my approach." And yet another one, "I cannot get feedback from students regarding their understanding of the lesson content. Also, it bothers me that students always have their cameras as turned off during classes." So there are positive experiences and not so positive experiences. And this is important for us to reflect on the potential, but also, of course, on the limitations, but mainly on the lessons learned out of the experience of both teachers, students, and teacher educators. Because, like I said, if the pandemic was universal, students, teachers, and teachers educators did not experience it the same way. But there was another challenge that I think it's important to identify very briefly, which relates to assessment. And according to research findings, assessment has become a critical issue. So when compared with classroom teaching prior to the pandemic, teachers report providing more feedback, more frequently and giving more importance to formative assessment. But at the same time, they also identify a decrease in student participation. So teachers highlighted how they use new methods and did away with others normally used in the classroom, especially in a context where national exams were suspended during the pandemic, as was the case in Portugal. So it seems that in teachers' accounts, there was a greater balance between summative and formative assessment, for example, through the implementation of feedback practices and the mobilization of digital ready formative strategies, but at the same time, the teachers report less student participation. To quote from one teacher, "The use of platforms for formative assessment in real time, autonomous work from the part of some students gives me more time to help students with difficulties." In another study, it was possible to identify the gains from the first to the second lockdown in terms of using digital tools, making tasks and materials more appropriate, using more online resources to teach, using pedagogical strategies in more innovative ways, more formative assessment, and a more balanced approach as to when and how to give students feedback. To quote from one teacher, "I have heard from colleagues who spoke of transforming their practices because of mask teachers had to move around the room and go to the back to the classes in order to be heard. And because circulating in the classroom creates opportunities for proximity and monitoring," and they talk about entering a self-regulation and the self-evaluation process. So this is an example how assessment was also a key issue in teachers' accounts about their experience during the pandemic. Another important and the final element in this topic, reconfiguration of teaching and learning, is related to the interpersonal and irreplaceable nature of in-person teaching. There were issues about how to maintain relationships and establish emotional connection with students, and how to sustain student engagement with learning. sorry. some teachers had to teach in a way that was far removed from what they would normally consider doing and how they would ideally like to teach. And so this had implications for teacher identity. I think the following testimony from this teacher is very eloquent or very illustrative. She said, "I can't move my classroom strategies to the screen. Not losing the interpersonal relationship was key, but it was terrible. I found myself crying sometimes, not in terms of despair, like I can't do it or this is not working, but just because this is not me. This is not the relationship that I want to establish with my students." Teachers emphasize the value of face-to-face teaching when they consider to be, which they consider to be irreplaceable, even though they recognize the importance of digital learning. The lack of student feedback and the lack of support together with tiredness explain the more negative experience of remote teaching. For instance, this teacher states the following: "Distance teaching was at a given moment a nightmare. It was very tiring and it brought me a sense of powerlessness, as I knew that only a few students were listening to me and were able to follow my teaching. I have learned to appreciate even more the importance of face-to-face contact with students and colleagues." So some teachers found themselves having to teach in ways that clashed with their professional values and beliefs, whether due to the inadequate conditions or lack of support, or due to difficulties in adapting to the new teaching scenario. So teachers' work and lives were therefore profoundly affected by the pandemic. And I would like now to move to the last theme, the social professional dimension of teachers' work. According to research, there were concerns from the part of the teachers more on students' financial situation and their families than about concerns about their financial, professional, and personal situation. This demonstrates the experience of teachers and the ways in which they were trying to do their best for the benefit of their students. Being a teacher during the pandemic involved more intense work in order to better support their students. Teachers report that they were entering students' homes and they learned a lot about their students' situation. They discovered some situations that they were not aware if the remote teaching didn't happen. But also, they also report a lack of time and difficulties in managing the various roles, along with a sense of tiredness and fatigue. For instance, this teacher quote is very also very illustrative. "From my experience, I have learned that working until physical and psychological exhaustion is not good. I used to work for 14 or 15 hours a day preparing during the first lockdown. And these have consequences. Preparing synchronous and asynchronous lessons with tasks for 212 pupils and also checking the tasks led me to take medical leave for the first time in almost 30 years of teaching. For me, the problem was the countless hours of preparation." So this quote and what I have said is also corroborated by other research, which points to an increase in workload, in stress, anxiety, and even burnout, but also a decrease in teacher well-being, as well as a lowering of their professional commitment and long-term perspectives. The difficulty to reconcile family and professional lives are reiterated in teachers' accounts with the lack of support and also frustration at not being able to reach all the students. Teachers often mention how human and physical resources were mobilized and frequently refer to the dynamics of collaboration and teamwork. They identify a lack of support at policy level, so they had to rely on collegiality and collaboration. And they do mention the mobilization of indigenous resources from their schools and local communities, and of course, collaboration. So when asked about the kind of support they received, they mention colleagues, tutors, so teachers that are responsible for a given class, leadership team, the department or year coordinators in their schools, the school principal, and the support team responsible for distance teaching. And less significant was the guidance or the support perceived and provided by the Ministry of Education, according to this research. This quote illustrates well how teachers rely on their on teacher collaboration. This teacher states that teachers had to have also done more collaborative work, sharing. It wasn't like an obligation, but COVID has shown us the added value that sharing brings, even for those who are more skeptical. So Hargreaves, in this regard, stresses teachers' professional skills, especially pedagogical expertise, to get together with their professional capital, and in particular, social capital in relation to how teachers share knowledge and ideas within collaborative cultures and professional networks. Teachers also emphasize their capacity for resilience and increased professional learning. They talk about the endless hours devoted to preparation, like we said previously, but also ongoing need to establish contact with students and their families. But they also stress the importance of the relational dimension of their work and their resilience and ability to adapt to the new context. I was impressed, this is to quote from one teacher, I was impressed with my capacity for resilience and adaptation. And this capacity was felt by the vast majority of my colleagues. Another topic to end this part relates to the emotions. As Hargreaves reminds us, teaching is an emotional practice, not only just a cognitive and intellectual one. COVID-19 cut deeply into the psychological rewards of teachers and teaching. And it goes on to say that the experience of COVID-19 has intensified many of the existing problems that with teachers' well-being. And this quote is illustrative of this. When I said that sometimes I was in tears, it had to do with my not being able to sort out problems that were not my responsibility, but still I took them on. I saw many colleagues despairing in the sense that they were not able to respond to multiple situations. This example illustrates the experience of some teachers. And because of time, I think I will skip this video and I can show it in the end if we have time. So now I will try to summarize some lessons learned and some implications for teaching and for teacher education. A deeper analysis of the impact of the pandemic on education requires time in order to consider all its multiple strands, but it is possible to identify some lessons learned. I think one key implication of the pandemic is the clear need to develop digital competencies in teacher education. It is, however, essential to move beyond a more instrumental approach to technology and to consider its ethical, political, and pedagogical dimensions. Such a view needs to go beyond a consumerist and replicative logic marked by standardization of procedures and by managerial control. So if digitalization is without a doubt unavoidable, it is also true that technology is not the curriculum, nor synonymous with curricular and pedagogical innovation. It is thus important that teacher education plays a part in building and supporting communities of learning by enhancing dynamics of research and encouraging the sharing and collaborative construction of knowledge. For example, consideration must be given to teachers' and students' roles and responsibilities in online educational experiences, including issues of power and control over teaching and learning. This means moving beyond the questions of what and how, and to consider why, who, and for what purpose in order to transcend the bureaucratic and managerial professionalism. There is a need to foster dimensions such as autonomy and commitments as part of occupational professionalism, but also teacher self-efficacy perceptions, as well as feelings of being part of a supportive learning community. The COVID-19 pandemic demanded an abrupt and unexpected shift to remote teaching, which brought about a state of generalized anomy or confusion at the beginning, but which also triggered a process of change in teaching and learning practices in real time under time pressure, with no possibility in the beginning of mediation or appropriate reflection. Research has shown that teachers' responses were characterized by two different logics. On the one hand, a logic of replication, suggesting that teachers try to replicate their face-to-face teaching in online environments without any kind of change or little change in their practices. But on the other hand, a logic of adaptation prevailed or was also possible. Which means that to a lesser or greater extent, teachers changed their practices and strategies as a result of using digital tools and online environments in their teaching. We can therefore identify both elements of change and permanence in teachers' practice. Remote teaching accentuated in a way the gap between more traditional practices centered on teaching, on written tests and grades, and more innovative ones oriented towards students' learning and support. As such, elements of a more transformational approach may be discussed, which includes not only changes in terms of tools and methods of teaching and assessment, but also the focus and the purpose of teaching and of assessment, as well as the role of teachers and students in teaching and learning. It remains to be seen whether the reported change do bring about substantive change within a logic of transformation, or instead a merely correspond to a contingent and temporary adaptation in response to the limitations imposed by the pandemic. I think it is important to explore whether teachers' experience, but also teacher educator experiences, is likely to be a catalyst for transforming their approaches and practices of teaching and of assessment in these post-pandemic times. Issues of diversity, differentiation, purpose, and the role of various stakeholders need to be considered. Thus, more needs to be done in regard to ensuring a more consistent transformation through, for instance, appropriate policies regarding teacher education and professional development. Teaching during the pandemic, like I said, moved from an initial state of confusion and anomie towards a rapid and a positive response. Yet, a universal and inclusive response was not possible despite teachers' best efforts. In addition, there were clearly a number of complex problems requiring changes beyond the mere contingent response to the pandemic and consideration both its primary impact, which has been investigated, but we need to go deeper and to investigate the secondary and the long-term effects of the pandemic. Gloria Ladson-Billings argues that the challenge of COVID-19 pandemic exposed several vulnerabilities affecting healthcare, the economy, climate, and educational disparities. And she advocates for the need to fundamentally rethink education and consider the pandemic as an opportunity to restart or to reset education using a more robust and culturally centered pedagogy. The latest UNESCO report also stresses that the pandemic has served to prove our fragility and our interconnectedness. The same report goes on to say that urgent action is needed to reimagine our futures, as well as the power of education to bring about profound change, and stressing also our in face of global disparities. And one of the key proposals in this report for renewing education is focuses on the teaching profession. Teaching should be professionalized as a collaborative endeavor, where teachers are recognized for their work as knowledge producers and key figures in educational and social transformation. This means that their autonomy and freedom must be supported, and that they must participate fully in public debates and dialogue on the future of education. And this, of course, when you talk about the professionalization of teaching, there are important implications for teacher education. But also, what the pandemic clearly has shown is the essential importance of teachers and of teaching. This experience represented an opportunity for teachers to develop digital competencies and adapt their usual ways of teaching to the new scenario. However, if the response by schools and teachers to the unexpected and sudden transition from face-to-face to remote teaching was generally effective, it also revealed different paces and processes of adaptation, which were associated with different organizational dynamics and digitalization cultures. In this regard, it should be emphasized the mobilization of endogenous resources within schools and local communities, but also the dynamics of collaboration and collegiality, as I already have mentioned. So this is emphasized within the context of a perceived lack of support and clear guidance at the policy level, thus testing the capacity of schools and teachers to reinvent themselves to meet the challenges of the new teaching environment. The translocation of teaching from a classroom setting to online platforms was an intense experience for teachers and also for teacher educators, as they felt the initial shock, but also created opportunities for them to collaborate and to rethink or reimagine or reconfigure their teaching practices. The same applied to teacher education. According to the literature, of course, we can identify a tension between, especially in the context of the practicum or online practicum, a tension between a real practice versus an ideal or idealized practice, as some student teachers didn't have the possibility to do a usual practicum in a classroom setting and in a physical school. So they had to learn about practice while no longer in practice. But at the same time, there was more time for reading and for reflection. And if we look at the literature, whereas there were challenges and difficulties, there were also positive experiences and even creative responses, which they relate to trust in professional expertise and judgment of teachers and of teacher educators, but also some creative responses in relation to the placements in virtual schools. So teacher educators, teachers, but also student teachers, they discover the potential of this new environment, and they develop creative and innovative innovative experiences and stances and practices during this virtual practical. And some of them relate really to the curriculum differentiation and to learning engagement. I think there was, I don't have time to explore, but there were in some cases a more democratic and inclusive perspective in how students and student teachers were engaged in how they could define their practicum experience and how they could mobilize their ideas and their strategies to teaching online with the cooperation of the cooperating teachers and also their students. So there are challenges, there were challenges, but there were also some positive experiences in this regard. So it is clear that in the post-pandemic time, change will be a key feature of education. Change in terms of a greater use of technology, affecting both students, teachers, teacher educators, as they become more proficient in their digital literacy. But it goes beyond that. There is a need to enhance flexible and innovative approaches to teaching and to teacher education, and to develop creative pedagogies to foster student engagement. However, if change is a keyword in thinking about the future of education and the future of teacher education in the post-COVID age, there are also elements of continuity, such as the importance of in-person interactions and the place of professional values and pedagogic principles associated with dialogical, student-centered, and flexible orientations to teaching. The value of face-to-face teaching has been strengthened and, in a way, revitalized as teachers and teacher educators have made sense of their experience in a changed and changing scenario. So if the COVID-19 pandemic raised questions about the ways in which we view education and teacher education, it is also true that we must not forget the problems and challenges that already existed prior to the pandemic. In particular, it is important to consider the conditions for teaching and learning in schools and classrooms, and how policies affect or even undermine curriculum innovation and pedagogy, as well as teachers' professional autonomy and collaboration, which are two key components of teacher professionalism. Also, a relevant support, including time and resources and appropriate opportunities for professional development, are crucial to enhance a more collaborative professionalism and to expand new spaces for joint professional learning and collective action. As Darling, Hammond, and Heiler assert, there is a need to invest in high-quality educator preparation, transforming learning opportunities in high-quality educator and transforming learning opportunities for professional educators to match current needs, supporting mentoring, and creating time for educators to collaborate with each other and key partners. And of course, the COVID-19 pandemic has also demonstrated the pedagogic agility of both teachers and teacher educators. And there is a need to draw on this experience and expand more diverse and creative approaches to teaching and teacher education. And to move on to my last slide, I just would like to emphasize two ideas that I think are very important. One relates to the issue of trust, agency, and professional learning, which are key elements when we talk about teacher professionalism, teacher educators professionalism, when we talk about teaching as a professionalized profession, and consistent and more coherent teacher education programs. And this also is important for us to rethink or reimagine new contexts and spaces for professional learning. We need to think about different structure and venues for teacher education, drawing on the experience that we have had with COVID-19 pandemic. But of course, as mentioned in the opening by the different participants, we still need to manage change and uncertainty in education and in teacher education. So we really need to reflect about this experience, and we need to go beyond contingent and temporary responses and to consider the teacher and teacher educators' voices and their capacity for action. This is really important when it comes to school reform or teacher education reform. But more importantly, if we need to pay attention to what is going on in Europe and beyond, it is important, and this is a crucial role from the Association for Teacher Education in Europe, is to continue the debate, the reflection, and to influence policies and influence decision makers in relation to what counts as teacher education, which means that there is a need to develop policies of teacher education which are consistent with more sophisticated and complex views of teaching. This is something that we need to continue to emphasize in order to counter-react some approaches that are more going in the opposite direction in terms of a deprofessionalization of teachers and of teacher education. So my final argument is that we need to take advantage of their experience during the pandemic, and now in the post-pandemic times we need to draw on this experience and try to influence policymakers in terms of the development of more coherent, consistent, and complex policies in relation to teacher education, which are consistent with this sophisticated nature of teaching. Thank you very much.
Do you hear us? You should hear us. It's very loudly. So, Professor Flores, do you hear us?
Yes,
she does.
Yes,
okay, so Professor, thank you very much. And you don't see it, but the hall is full. So we can say that we didn't left the room, which means that it was quite interesting. Thank you very much, and applause for you and for your presentation. And it is really pity that you couldn't come here, but yes, of course, some things could happen and changes should be made thanks to technology that we could manage that. Thank you very much again. And now some words for participants. You have been very patient. I hope that I used a correct form of English, but you understand, I hope. So a coffee break is outside somewhere, that direction. You go out and go that direction. And then after that, we will have next keynote speak. Please come back. It will be in person, so he will see that you are here or not here. And if someone doesn't remember the program, we also have QR code. This one is for program. You can enter our webpage and then you can see what is going on here. So see you later.